And it's my great pleasure to welcome all of you to this historic lecture in our series, because this is the 25th lecture in the series of STIP lectures, which have been held monthly now for, well, obviously over 2 years. So it's a great pleasure indeed that this series, which was thought of as a collaborative venture between some of the institutions housed at the India Habitat Center, as well as Vigyan Prasar, has been steadily marching through time and has maintained its record of having regular programs and very well attended programs usually. Today the crowd seems to be a little thinner. I don't know for what reason, but usually we have an overflowing house, and I think some more people are still coming in. So it's a great pleasure to be here on this occasion when it's the 25th lecture in the series, and to thank you all for being here. We have covered a very vast variety of topics in the lectures, and this time we are turning towards IT and IT training, which is again a topic I think which we have not earlier covered really in this series. So we are breaking new ground all the time. I won't take up very much of your time, but because I know that Ambassador Balakrishnan has some important announcements also to make, and of course he will introduce our guest speaker, whom I also wish to thank very much indeed. Thank you, Professor Modgalia, for coming here to deliver this lecture all the way from IIT Bombay. Thank you very much. Over to the chair.
Thank you, Mr. Tandon, for that introductory address, and thank you for the support of the India Habitat Center over the past 2 years. Also, thanks to all the partner institutions. I won't name them all, but I think they're all out there, who have worked with us so over the last 2 years to keep this lecture series going. Today we have, since we have reached the 25th lecture, it's an important milestone. So what RIS has done is it has brought out in a print form all the lectures which have been organized by RIS over the last 2 years. I believe they are all here in this forum. So since I'll take advantage of Professor Modgalia being here to ask him to release this. So this is indeed an outstanding and a remarkable collection. It has the very first lecture by Dr. R. Chidambaram, who was the chairman of our Atomic Energy Commission and is really one of the outstanding drivers of our nuclear program, both civil and strategic. And it goes on to have Professor Anurag Agarwal on artificial intelligence and healthcare, and Professor K. Vijayaraghavan, the present PSA to the Government of India on building a knowledge economy, etc. I won't go into detail, but I think it's a very rich collection.
Yeah, I think the chair to also say that there is it included a printing of a lecture given by Ambassador Dr. Balakrishnan himself as well on technology and Indian foreign policy trends and opportunities. That is also included in this printed.
Thank you. And all the lectures series, the details are given here. They are accessible online, the internet. You can see them as a video, or you can also download the text. So now let's come to today's session, which I'm sort of very eagerly looking forward to. And as most of you are young people from the developing countries, I'm sure it will be also of great interest to you. We all know that IT and ICT is a very, very important factor in all our economies. Countries which have been able to effectively use ICT have moved ahead. Countries which haven't, they've fallen behind. So as we have moved from agrarian to industrial to service economy and now knowledge economy, ICT is very, very important. And today we have Professor Kannan M. Modgalia from IIT Bombay, who has spent a lot of his time and research on bringing ICT, knowledge of ICT, to the common man. And not only to the common man in India, but all across the world. If you look at his website, there are 33 plus languages in which ICT education is being imparted. And even to me, it was a surprise that even a language like Bodo, which is one of the relatively unknown languages in northeastern India, that is also being. So it's quite a remarkable feat that in a quiet and rather quiet manner, he has been able to put together all this information. And not only that, I think he has also been participating in a program in Myanmar to impart ICT capacity building there. And I think there's no limit to the potential for this kind of work in all our countries. So his biodata is already here. So I will not go over the whole thing, but since we also have to use our time. And so without any further ado, I'll hand over the mic to him to make his presentation.
Thank you, Ambassador Balakrishnan. And thank you also, Mr. Tandon. I have come here many times to this very particular building to participate in several MHRD deliberations, but never had a chance to meet you. So really happy that I could see you in this beautiful building. Okay. I want to thank all the participants who have come here to listen to me. Hopefully I'll be able to share something with you that you can take back or also help me improve it further, okay? So this is the outline of my talk. So first let me take up my spoken tutorial. I have some examples also. What is a spoken tutorial? It is a 10-minute long audio video tutorial created using screencast. Screencast means you record the screen to teach open source software for employment. For employment is the main thing, as I told you in the morning itself. Jobs. So the first question that I asked at that time was, can we train our students on IT topics through self-learning? Because many students don't have good teachers. So we said self-learning. We came up with a solution as a novice check of the script. All movies start with scripts, whereas my talk here is extempore. There is no script, right? But we said that our tutorials will be based on a script and ask a beginner to certify that they can understand the script before recording. So I have illustrated this using this figure. You write a script, then ask the question, can a beginner understand it? Very often the answer is no, because the script is created by an expert and the beginner doesn't necessarily understand all steps. So if they cannot understand, it is not acceptable. We ask them, okay, improve the script. It goes in a loop. It can happen many times, okay? Some of our tutorials took several iterations before converging. Finally, thankfully, it passes, and then we accept the script and then record a video using that script. So the script not approved by a beginner is returned for improvement. After passing the novice check, the script is used to create a spoken tutorial. So this is the basic philosophy. I believe that this is fundamental to our work.
Welcome to the spoken tutorial on embedding mathematics in XFIG.
So this is one.
In this tutorial.
The next question is, what if the learners are not fluent in English? This is also a very important question for us. So we said, let's dub the audio into all 22 Indian languages, but we have many more languages also on our website.
C++ mein constructors aur destructors ke spoken tutorial mein aapka swagat hai.
Is tutorial mein hum
spoken tutorial cha creating basic content varil paathat aaple swagat.
Flow sheeting ku arimugam kuritha spoken tutorial ku nalvaravu.
This is in Tamil.
जावा इत्यस्मिन् अंकगणितीय प्रक्रियायाः पाठं प्रति स्वागतम्। अस्मिन् पाठे वयं विविधाः
सो व्हाट लैंग्वेज इज इट? इट इज संस्कृत। नाउ इफ आई कैन डब इट इन संस्कृत, आई कैन डब इट इनटू एनी लैंग्वेज, राइट? बिकॉज़ पीपल से दैट लुक, देयर आर नॉट मेनी पीपल हु स्पीक संस्कृत, इट इज अ डेड लैंग्वेज एंड सो ऑन। इवन इन दैट वी आर एबल टू डब। इट हैपेंस टू बी वन ऑफ आवर 22 लैंग्वेजेस। We have lots of languages, but then our constitution identified 22 languages in the Schedule 8 of our constitution. So we said we will dub it into all 22 languages. Oops. Okay. Yeah, I could have reopened, right? Because of the video and some animation, there was some problem. So hopefully, no, it won't open. Let me open that. So we have more than 1,000 tutorials in English. Remember, each tutorial is of 10-minute duration. We have 10,000 tutorials, including dubbing. These are useful in our neighboring countries also, because without any additional expense, because we have common languages, so they can use them. These are already created with funds given by our taxpayers. We dub in international languages also.
Bienvenido al tutorial hablado de LibreOffice Writer. Teclado y formateo básico de texto.
Okay.
Bienvenido a Spoken Tutorial en LibreOffice Calc Working with Cells. En este tutorial vamos a aprender cómo inserir números, texto, números como texto, data y...
Apparently it's Portuguese spoken in Portugal. It's the same thing spoken in Goa, right? We have dubbing in several other languages as well. The next question we asked was, so two questions I already asked. Can somebody who doesn't have a teacher understand? Self-learning, now is check of the script. Second one, we said, what if they don't understand English, not fluent in English? So we did that. If you remember, we are not changing the video when we do the dubbing. The video remains in English, which allows our children to use normal computers, normal keyboards that are used in IT companies, okay, which is in English. So they are able to use that. And it's a dream of our children, no matter to which class they belong to, they want to work in an IT company. They want to go anywhere in the world, work and so on and so forth. You want to make it accessible to them also, even though they may not be fluent in English. The third question we ask is, can one access spoken tutorials even if internet is not available, even if bandwidth is not available? Imagine a need to have, you know, 25, 30 computers, each one pulling a video stream. So that may require a lot of bandwidth we may not have, especially in schools, rural areas, and so on. So how do we make it available to them? We made an offline application so that one can download an entire thing as a zip file. What I will do is, I have another version because I have already shown the videos, so I no longer need Acrobat. Yeah, so I think this will work. This will not crash. Okay. We made an offline application that allows a person to download an entire series as a zip file. If they don't have, of course, download it, that means they need one internet connection. It can be downloaded over a period of time, 2 days, 1 day, whatever, overnight. Then once you have the zip file, unzip it, copy it into every machine, and it opens locally. In fact, I have one such version made Let me just see if I can show that to you, because this is extremely important, because this resulted in our video's usage going up 100 times. 100 times. Okay, without that, we could not have succeeded. So, if you download the zip file, if you unzip it, you will have these files, and there is a file called index.html. If you open it, it opens from a file. Look at the URL, it says file, open from file. And if you look at the last one, it says index.html, because I opened the file index.html. And only things that I download, I create, will be available. Here, there are only two series. This writer is like MS Word, calc is like Excel. So let me choose that. Only language that I downloaded will be there. So that is Gujarati. So for example, if I say working with data, I play it.
LibreOffice Calc ma data sathe kivi rite kaam karu te sikhvarta amri mouse khasedo. Aa cell mouse button ne chodo. Cell apoap athvadiyana divas apmele kramankit serial number sathe. Have apne sheet 2 temas apne chelli kimat 6 chodo. Cell menu bar ma edit vikalp par click karo.
Something unusual. Normally one has to flush out the buffer before it rewinds and starts playing. Okay. Oops. Something I have to find out. So, presentation is okay. So you can download that. If you don't have even one connection, somebody can download it, cut a CD and send it to you. They can use it. Copy it into every machine and then do that. As I mentioned, this spoken tutorial access went up 100 times so that we could conduct large workshops. Here, 250 people, they're all college teachers from Mumbai, city of Mumbai. They're all using it simultaneously. I could not have done this with an online version. We could even conduct a workshop in Myanmar where we had to wait for electricity to take this photograph. When I went there a few years ago, even the electricity was not reliable. Forget about internet. Here, all the things were copied onto the hard disk. Software was already installed. Okay, we use only open source software. People could download, install it. Our videos were installed. And the battery was fully charged. So it doesn't matter, they didn't have electricity. They could do this workshop. You can see that all of them are using only laptops. They don't use desktop. They didn't use desktop, at least at that time. To summarize, your spoken tutorial is a 10-minute long audio-video tutorial created for self-learning. In fact, I will say guaranteed for self-learning. Audio dubbed into 22-plus languages, downloadable for offline use. These tutorials are released under Creative Commons CC BY-SA, Creative Commons Attribution Share-alike license I mentioned in the morning. We also made a decision that one can access this without even logging in. We don't ask for internet, we don't ask for registration, login, because we found that the moment you make that mandatory, 90% of the people leave. So we said, doesn't matter, we don't need to know who they are, let them come and use it. And so these are policy decisions, both are policy decisions. We recommended a method called side-by-side method. What is a side-by-side method? In a computer screen, in one half of the screen, open the video, that is a spoken tutorial. On the other half, you open the software itself, right? Listen to a command, pause the command, try it on the software. If it works, go to the next command. If it doesn't work, rewind, listen to it, try again. It will always work because it is created for self-learning. This side-by-side learning reduces cognitive overload, especially for beginners, especially for our target audience. They see it, they practice it. And of course, this can be done only if we use open source software. If we use commercial software, we cannot ask all the students to download. Where will they download from? Or nor can we ask them to pirate it. It's illegal, right? So we go for open source software. Everybody can do this, learn this legally. So the next question, are these design decisions useful? Okay, we made design decisions and then created our instructional material accordingly. Are these design decisions useful? We trained 5 million students in the last 5 years. 100 universities with 4,000 affiliating colleges now officially use spoken tutorials. I have a sample of what are the different topics we have. Introductory topics. Okay, this is for, you know, clerical staff and so on. And these are very popular with our students because these help our students get jobs, even for advanced programmers, for website creation and so on, for simulation users, those who want to simulate real life systems and so on, graphic artists. There are many courses. There are 75 different courses and growing. Okay. The next question we asked, actually the ministry asked me, we are funded by the Ministry of Human Resource Development. They asked me, if you claim that it is so good, can you raise some money? Will people pay? It is so good. You are saying it is fantastic. Can you raise some money from the users? Then we will believe you. Okay. So we went for a paid model for online test and certification in August 2008, about 15 months ago. So I have a comparison. What became paid? So I compare on license, registration, login, open source software, online test. So before August 2018, so we had license, CCBYSA, no registration, login, open source software, online test was free. After this time, after August 2018, we made only the online test paid. Everything else continues to be the same as before, okay? And what we did was we said there is an annual, it's a subscription-based model, institutional model. Annual subscription is 25,000 rupees. This is about, let's say, $350 of that order per year, per institution. And any number of students in that institution can appear in any number of tests. And if they pass the test, they will get a certificate. Okay? The test is administered in their colleges. And we asked a college teacher to invigilate and put their name on that certificate so that they have to take responsibility. In case there is some bad practices, the teacher gets caught or the college gets caught that this college doesn't use straightforward methods. Okay, this is one way to keep the cost low, that we don't have to pay for an invigilator. This is the only way I can keep the cost low. And our cost is very small. It is only 25,000 rupees, $350 per year. Any number of students can appear in any number of tests. So I told our government officials that we will bring in 400 colleges in the first year. Okay. But we could actually get in 850 colleges in 15 months. So that, you know, in fact, MHRD is very happy with me. They believe now, yes, it is indeed useful. Okay. Interestingly, there are some other advantages also I'm going to explain. The cost of a single certificate can be 25 rupees. That means one-third of a dollar, for example. Why? Because a college can take, you know, there are lots of students. We have 1,000 students, 2,000 students. If 5,000 certificates are issued to a college, then immediately it is 5 rupees. Here I'm saying 25 rupees. That means you need only 1,000 certificates to be issued to a college in a year. And they pay only 25,000 rupees. Okay. Now I told you that there are some more benefits. What are those? Before August 2018, training resulting in tests used to be about 15%. We trained lots of people. How many people took the test? Because our government would always ask, I'm paying you, Tell me how good it is. You tell me that so many people got trained. How many people really got trained? If they really got trained, they would have taken the test. What is that percentage? It used to be 15%. Okay? And we used to call, we used to request people, we used to beg, please come and test. It is very good for you. Okay? But after the paid scheme was introduced, amongst the paid colleges, now it is not available to other people. You want to take the test? Okay, come to our scheme. So it has gone to 50%. Okay? The colleges are telling their students, encouraging them, look, I have paid. Why don't you get the benefit out of it? Appear in the test, it's going to help you get jobs. If the students get jobs, it is good for the college, because the college publishes, advertises every year. So many of our students get placed. Okay? So that's the reason why you should join me. That's the reason why you should join me. I have a lot of seats. Please come. Right? So now we have become a facilitator. We no longer request people to come. We go after these colleges to pay. There are some states Orissa and Telangana. The state governments have said that here are 100 colleges, I'll pay you this money, total money, and they will monitor. They call the principal of the college and say, why your students are not participating. So in other words, this payment has actually resulted in many more people taking it seriously. And I'm aiming to reach 75% level, I believe, which is, it is achievable. So the question is, in this particular case, the payment has resulted in higher efficacy, but of course we have kept the cost very low. Because the cost of a certificate can be a third of a dollar, as I mentioned. It can be lower as well. The next topic I want to take up is massive blended training for teachers. Until now, I talked about student training, right? Now I said, why can we use this to train the teachers? Because the teachers can train 100 people, 100 students. So there, the multiplication factor is enormous. Can we go for teacher training with this? Some of the issues that we face perhaps are similar to what you might also face. This was done by my colleague who ran this project called T10KT. T10KT stands for Train 10,000 Teacher Project, in which he set up what are known as remote centers. So there are a total of 550 remote centers that he established, and each of them has a video conferencing system, and so they can connect with us, and they use a software called AView, which is an open source software, so one doesn't have to pay for it. It was also funded by MHRD, and it is possible to connect with all of them. Interestingly, our IIT Bombay's outgoing bandwidth is never used. When we say you need bandwidth, you're talking about your students downloading things. Okay, this is true of every institution. Your outgoing bandwidth is almost never used. So that is what that gets used. Because other colleges that connect with us through this video conferencing unit will start pulling. That means your other bandwidth also gets used. So in other words, it was not used before. You get an opportunity to put it to use. Okay. This, I'll be using this abbreviation RC, which stands for remote center. There are 550 remote centers that we established. It was established by my colleague, Professor Fatak, in computer science. So what we do is, we conduct pilot workshops with spoken tutorials, make sure that it is perfect, it will go through without any problem, and take it up. Then we say, we connect all the RCs, all the remote centers, and we train one person from each of the remote centers. Sometimes they may even come in person, right? So we do the coordinator workshop. Each center will send one person. We train one person from each of these, collect them all together, and do it as a contact workshop, or do it remotely through the same method. After doing that, then next step is these coordinators will coordinate people coming to learn in their centers. So we have lots of centers. These are in different parts of the country. So the teachers from those areas need to go to only those locations. I have some videos shortly. So what is the process? These are one-day workshops. Although I have 550 remote centers, about 100 to 200 remote centers join depending on the topic. Teachers of colleges go there and they actually pay fees, okay? Which is unusual because generally teacher training is completely funded by the government. And I said that you have to pay. You want to participate? Not much. It's only about $7, $8, but you still have to pay. And I will not pay for your travel. I will not pay for your accommodation. You have to come on your own. But it is only one day. You can go to the nearest city, nearest center, go in the morning and go back in the evening. So your travel expenses are not much. You don't have to stay anywhere, right? But you have to pay 500 rupees. Out of the 500, 100 is given to me so that I know exactly how many people are coming, so that I can take care of logistics. The remaining 400 is given by the teacher to the remote center where they go, and out of that they pay lunch. They arrange lunch, coffee, tea, snacks, and so on, right? And if there is any balance left, they can use it to cover some of their operational expenses. So this is something different. We have had situations where the teacher training is completely funded, and some teachers think that it is a paid vacation. They don't take it seriously. Here, only serious people will come. But I'll show you the numbers, how many people we are able to convince and take our course. We connect through AVU, open source video conferencing unit. We connect through the remote centers. We talk to all of them, and we say, this is the way the workshop will be conducted. Now you are on your own. Learn through spoken tutorials. Okay? We connect through AVU, open source video conferencing tool. We explain the learning procedure. Learning happens through spoken tutorials. And then used time discussion forum for question and answers. We even conducted some hardware experiment. In fact, I have a sample. I'll see towards the end of the talk. If I have time, I'll actually show you. We could even ship 3,200 such units to different parts of the country. In fact, we even took it to Myanmar. It must be the first time a hardware-based experiment was conducted in such a large scale. So is this approach working? We conducted a workshop on Koha, which is a library management software for 2,500 librarians. And then we repeated that. Then we conducted this workshop on Moodle, which is a learning management software. 4,359 teachers joined. Here, I have written the number of centers. Okay, Scilab, 164 remote centers, 4,300 people. Python, very popular, this is the most popular till now, 5,200 people. Linux we conducted, large number once again. eSIM we conducted. What are these 1, 2, 3? I'll show you. 1 stands for Afghanistan, 2 stands for Bangladesh, 3 stands for Myanmar. In fact, Myanmar joined in all the last three workshops. So these are the 190 R workshop locations in different parts of India, and you can see Myanmar here. So they also joined. Okay, it is easy to extend this to other people, provided there is a convenient time, that there is a good time. Africa, we can certainly connect. The difference is not too much. So here is the eSIM workshop at Myanmar. Let me see if it works. Okay, it depends on the internet speed. Let's see whether. No, I connected previously also. I know what to do. I have already downloaded here. Okay, I play this.
Thank you, Professor Kannan. We at MIIT are extremely privileged.
This is Myanmar. This is in Mandalay, Myanmar.
That we part of it. And today we have 25 participants from 6 universities here nearby Mandalay region. The next time around when we participate, we'll book this venue the video conferencing room to a larger place where I'm hoping to have about 100 people. Thank you for letting us in. We are very grateful to you.
Thank you, Dr. Raja. Sitting next to him is Dr. Sinha, and he has been an energetic person. He made sure that things are available. Dr. Sinha, would you want to say hello to the participants from there?
Yes, good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Okay. Yeah. So here is an example. In another that was eSIM, then R. So here you see Myanmar. They have shifted to a bigger place. Let's see whether I can play that.
Do you have anybody who can say something? Professor Venkatesh is there.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, this is MIIT.
Yeah,
this is MIIT. There is no particular questions. Thank you.
Okay, so you have a flavor of how this thing happens. So we have a video conference. We connect with each other. We talk to them, and then they go and do the workshop themselves. They ask questions in the forum, we answer them. The tutorials are created for self-learning already, right? Next workshop we are planning to do on Arduino, which is a microcontroller. It's a popular open source microcontroller. We plan to do that. That is going to be in the month of January and February. Next, I'm going to take up the topic of health and nutrition. I told you in the morning about the reason why we are promoting breastfeeding. So here is the doctor, Rupal Dalal, who is promoting this. In fact, she used to train about 1,000 people a year. I told her, you join hands with us, we will help reach 100,000 using our technology. Now she goes and she doesn't have to, our video plays, and then she doesn't have to talk and conduct this workshop. And she believes that males also have to be trained so that they understand the importance of this. Sorry, I'm not able to play because this embedding doesn't work on this. So we have spoken tutorials on breastfeeding. Our Hindi dubbing of global health videos received more than 3 million views. Very popular. The reason for doing this is, we said that IT training is actually IT skills training. IT skills is one type of skill. Why don't we extend it to other type of skills? So we said that let's go for breastfeeding. What I can do is, let me see if I can show you live on our web page so that you also get to see our spoken tutorial website. This is our spoken tutorial webpage, spoken-tutorial.org. Okay. What I will do is, I will continue to talk without taking time like this. I'll open it like this. If it comes, we will know when that happens. There it is. So, you can see that it is very slow. Okay, so we will see if we can do this later. Even if I press this, you can see how important offline immersion is. You see, we are in Delhi, right? And the internet speed is not that good. So this offline version is extremely important, right? We'll skip that, you believe me, it's available on our website. So we created 15 spoken tutorials on breastfeeding. Oops. So what should I do? Presentation is okay. So babies of male god, for example. So I have several examples. We have a place called Male God. It's a tiger reserve. So anybody does male god, they will say it's a great place to see tigers. But the people who live there tribals, their children have a lot of problems. Nobody knows about them, right? Malnutrition is very high. I have a link here, but unfortunately I will not show that. Basically, it's an article that talks about, you can see the link there. It talks about male god children. So many children die annually, 400 children die annually. I have some pictures. These are the babies that got, that we have now, thanks to exclusive breastfeeding. Okay, it's really working, right? Yeah, some more babies. This Muzaffarpur, Bihar, is another location in India. The malnutrition levels are worse than that of sub-Saharan African countries. Really, really bad. We have extremes in India. We have some outstanding places. There are some places that are really bad. Okay, this is one of those places. Okay. We are also currently working on vaccination, menstrual hygiene, family planning, etc. We hope to create many more tutorials in this series. Okay. How much more time I have? A few more minutes? 5 minutes? Okay. So there is one last topic I wanted to take up because I mentioned Brazil in the morning. So I wanted to talk about collaborative work that we can undertake in many of the topics, not necessarily through the spoken tutorial. Spoken tutorial means you use that, you say that I'm going to spread it in a big way. Then the students ask, okay, what do I do next? I have educated myself. Can I contribute? Can I create something? Can we work together? So to answer that, I have given this, the next topic that I have. So I have called it international collaboration in open source software and hardware. I was not planning to include it in the morning, but then after some of the questions that came in the morning, I said, why don't I include it so that we can go through some of these as well, some of the collaboration that we have. So I'm going to explain it using a software called DWSim for chemical process simulation. So we have many colleges, 350 colleges in India that offer chemical engineering education. There are 15,000 graduates. If they get jobs, it's going to be in the IT area, not in chemical engineering, because their jobs are very few, which may also vanish thanks to the impending automation, AI, and you know, things like that. And this is going to happen in many other fields as well. Because if you depend only on IT, and all these people get jobs only in the bottom end of IT, and they get automated, they have to find some other job. It's a serious problem. At the same time, many small companies of ours don't get any technology input, because our smart students don't want to go to these small companies. For every Reliance, which is a large company, or a Shell or Exxon, we have 10,000 small companies that do not get any engineering input. So why don't they do something? Why don't they recruit these students? They won't recruit these students because these students know nothing. Because they work, they study in really bad colleges, not necessarily good education they get. So we need to bring them up, and we can do that using spoken tutorials that we have. So why not train the students and make them available to small companies? Use DWSim for this. DWSim is created by Daniel Wagner of Brazil, as I mentioned in the morning. Okay, it's an open source software they created. You just look for the best one, start using it. This campaign is explained next. So we created 20 spoken tutorials on this topic. We sent this poster to every college, and we said, why don't you learn this? Solve a chemical engineering flow sheet. Send it to me. If it is correct, I'll give you honorarium certificate. More importantly, I'll give a link on my website to your work, which you can share. Many students have shared it with companies and so on, got internship, got jobs, got assistantship to some US universities for higher studies and so on. So this link actually helps these children a lot, and the certificate also helps a lot, okay? Because whatever may be the college, however rural area it might be, there are always a few good students, and they don't have a platform. So here we are creating a platform to express themselves, okay? So 132 flow sheets completed. Each one is a different chemical process. They have given a solution to that, right? now available through DWSim also. I'll be happy to share this slide with you, and all the links are available. In case you want to go and see, you can click the link, you'll be able to see. Okay, 100 more are in progress, and so I'm going to invite small companies to use DWSim. Interestingly, many big companies were very interested in this software. Okay, because even the big companies that use commercial software, they have only one license, because these are very expensive. They have some 10, 20 engineers waiting to use that software. So during the waiting time, they can always use the open source software, and only the final run has to be validated in the commercial software. So they are also actually interested in this. Okay. Proposed custom models in DWSim. So I'm going to skip this. I'm going to give an example of a collaborative hardware work. So this is something developed by us. FOSSI stands for Free and Open Source Software for Education. In fact, that's a FOSSI logo. This is the Spoken Tutorial logo. I'm the PI, principal investigator of both the projects. We created this hardware and gave it to some of our collaborators who created the software to drive this. Okay. In fact, we wrote a joint paper. You can see Alois is from Austria and Tiago is from Portugal. He lives in the US. He's a student in University of Alabama. So we gave them the hardware and they were very happy, and then they suggested some modifications. They gave the software. So we established international collaboration as well. Some of these things are going actually very well. So that brings me, because I was given about half an hour, I wanted to give a flavor of what we do. To conclude, Spoken Tutorial is a proven method to self-learn IT topics. Self-learn, that word self-learn is extremely important. T10KT, train 10,000 teachers, can train tens of thousand people simultaneously. A blend of the above two has been found to be effective. We have trained 20,000, actually it has gone to about 25,000 teachers, librarians. Learners paid for fees, teachers paid for fees, travel and stay, right? Because to pay TADA, travel allowance and so on for 20,000 people, it becomes very expensive. Our government cannot pay. Breastfeeding skills, Spoken Tutorials are very popular. And we trained 15,000 health workers and mothers in the last 1 year using this method, okay? And we are planning to extend to other topics as well. Some of them I mentioned earlier. I believe that IT training is only the tip of the iceberg. We believe that many skills, skill training can be imparted through this method. It is extremely useful to everyone, especially to the marginalized people around the world. I invite like-minded people amongst you to join us in this quest. Our project is funded by the National Mission on Education through ICT, I mentioned in the morning, and the Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission on Teachers and Teaching, through which we are training the teachers now. MHRD stands for Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. So this is our Spoken Tutorial team. You will see lots of ladies, you will see a few males. Same thing happens in T10KT team. This is our FOSSI team, right? So it has happened that way. I didn't tell my managers, they're all ladies, and many of them happen to be wives of faculty colleagues. Okay, they're available, they're highly talented, and they motivate people, and we get the work done. I have about 200 full-time staff members working with me on all these projects. I want to thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll have about 15 minutes for questions. So my request is that keep the questions short, and if you have long comments, then we can always deal with them after the session. So that way everyone gets a chance to participate, okay?
First of all, are there any questions?
Yes.
Yeah. Can you just identify yourself also, because I don't know you, I want to get in.
I'm Devin Ragasa, I'm from Trinidad. My question is simple. how well has industry accepted your training? Usually when you think about these open online courses, these MOOCs, it's usually for skills development, personal development, sometimes professional development, not necessarily for entry into the industry.
So good question. I have an answer to that.
Has industry accepted it without the qualification?
I have an answer to that. In fact, we recently conducted a job fair. What we did was, in the last 1 year, 15 months, about 200,000 people have taken online tests. We contacted all the people who scored 80% and above, and we wrote to them, will you be interested in joining a job fair? And then we went and told the companies, some good students are coming, would you want to talk to them? Would you want to interview them? So it happened. Unfortunately, because it was a short notice, out of the 2,000 people we invited, only 56 people came, and there were four companies, and they were all very interested. About 10 people got placed. Some are internship, some are doing internship, some of them possibly for jobs as well. So I talked about this to NASSCOM. NASSCOM is our apex body for all IT companies. They were all excited. They said that they would like to organize such a workshop exclusively as a workshop. Previously, it was conducted along with Drupal Camp. Now it is going to be, we are going to do this in January. If you think about it, even the companies have problems in identifying good people, right? Some companies have to go to several colleges to identify one good student. Here, I'm giving them on a platter. So they are very happy. C programming is C programming, whether you use Turbo C or GCC or whatever. So the answer is an unqualified yes. Right? Of course, we have several testimonials. Even when it was free, there is a college called Manakula Vinayagar College in Pondicherry. And the principal wrote to us, it is on our website. He said about 80 people got TCS jobs. TCS stands for Tata Consultancy Services. Out of the 80, about 70 acknowledged that they learned the required expertise through spoken tutorial. So the answer is yes. Because remember, ours is active learning. Unlike MOOCs that you talked about, what is MOOCs? You listen to it. Here we mandate through the side-by-side learning, they have to reproduce every command. As a matter of fact, I tell my students, look, online test is not required for you. Why do you need a test? You have reproduced all the commands. You know everything. You don't need a test. But then the Indian mentality is that everybody wants a test. That's why even though I promised only 400 colleges, 850 joined, right? So there is a difference between our method and other methods. Okay, any other question? Yeah.
Yes, I'm Chinnapop from Thailand. Thank you for the wonderful lecture. My question would be that how would you assess and do the test? Because to me, many IT skills require both theoretical skills and practical skills. So how does all the test
good
assessment?
Point. In fact, let me modify this question in a different way. Can one teach theoretical topics through self-learning? Can I teach theory of relativity through self-learning? My answer is, I don't know. So that's why I didn't even venture into that. So in other words, I don't teach mathematics through this method. I don't teach physics through this. I teach only IT skills. What you can see, practice, become good, that is a limited area that I am focusing on. So I don't teach fluid mechanics through that. I don't teach algorithms. I don't teach data structures. But if there is a software, through examples I can teach, I can do that. I do that. But then, number of people who have to be given skills training in India is 500 million. 500 million students have to be trained in skills alone. So it is a restricted area. What you say is quite true. We are teaching only a part of it. Okay, but what I can say is, I want to find out who are the really motivated people through this method, right? I conduct a test. I select, let's say, top 1,000 people who score 80% and above, and I invite them. Would you want to come for a contact course wherein some faculty member will come and address all of you live through our T10KT mode at all the remote centers? You can ask them questions. It is not self-learning. So it's a question of how we, you know, do all that. My method per se doesn't do that, but my method permits that, right? Because the point is, when I conduct a workshop for 20,000 people, how many people are really interested? And in fact, they will come and say, it is time to go home, right? Here is a faculty member who says, I want to finish, this is an important area. And this person says that time to go home, right? And there is another person who says, the you know, the dal that you gave is very spicy. I'm not here running a restaurant, right? Why are you not interested in the subject? Ask questions on that, right? It is possible for me to filter out all those people who are not interested using these methods, and then you can really conduct a high-end program, contact program. Is that okay? Any other question? Go ahead, please. Give the mic here.
Yeah, Professor, you are just taking care of 80% people. But need of the hour is for people who are not in this range. They are lower than this range. So how to address them?
Good point. Good point. So the question is, only 80%, I'm looking at people who score 80% and above. Okay? In fact, I have something called attainable pyramids of excellence. Okay? Let me show you that. I removed it because, skim. Okay, so first method, you train lots of people, spoken tutorial. Then we tell them, okay, now that you have learned, do something, contribute something. Flow sheet, for example, I mentioned, custom models, warm flow sheets, and so on. At every point, you keep selecting somebody better, somebody better, somebody better, right? Now, finally, I am at the top of the pyramid. These people are ready to take up major projects, entrepreneurship, and so on. Now, when that happens, these people can be placed anywhere in the world, any multinational. The moment it happens, the fellow just below them will say, hey, I could have done this. I could have done that. Okay? So they will go up. At every level, people will go up. In fact, the whole pyramid will get lifted. So I call it attainable pyramid of excellence. Can you give an example of an unattainable pyramid of excellence? Can you think of one? IIT BTech, for example. You miss it, that's it. You can't make it. It is IIT BTechs or an unattainable pyramid of excellence because we select only 1% of the people who aspire to study in IIT. Right? It's unattainable. Here, they can do it anytime. Right? The person who is 70 will say, I could have got 80 if I had been a little more motivated. And remember, our tutorials are created for self-learning. Guaranteed. Why did everybody not get 100? That is my question. Because they were not interested. They were not sure. But the moment something happens, then everybody goes up. The whole pyramid gets lifted. Okay? Any other question? How many people would want to use this in your countries? It's available for free. It's available for free. For example, So here it is.
And it's available in Spanish.
No, we don't have too many.
I must say that professor's website, when I got to know of it, it actually, I wanted to learn Python for quite a while. I've been keeping putting it off because of these books on learning Python and all. The problem there is you read it, and then you try to type the code, the syntax goes off. And here the side-by-side is revolutionary because missing out even a comma or a space or something immediately does. So it's no better way of learning it than actually typing the code.
In fact, what I tell is, if there are enough number of small steps, anybody can climb Himalayas. Anybody can climb Himalayas. Give small, small steps. And each one goes through novice check created for self-learning. It's very easy. So anybody who's motivated, remember what I told. There is this girl who is the daughter of a maid servant, construction worker, rickshaw driver. She talks to the son of a professor. Look, I'm starting at a lower level, but I'm willing to sleep 1 hour less. I'm willing to work harder than you. Can I reach your level? Okay? In our method, it is possible because things are created for self-learning. Right?
Your question also about theoretical knowledge is very interesting. I believe that things like relativity, quantum mechanics can be very effectively taught through these kind of methods. It all depends. I mean, you must, those of you who have studied physics would probably know in the 80s there was a Feynman lectures in physics. There was like no other textbook. And that really brought a lot of advanced physics to the undergraduate community. So another area is languages. There's no better way of learning a language than through this method. Not only do you learn the language, but your accent becomes perfect. So there's a wide variety of applications. The other day I asked somebody working at home to go and fix some electrical repair. And he came, I was sure he wouldn't be able to do it. He came and did it. I said, how did you do it? He said, I went to YouTube. I saw how to fix this. And I fixed it. So the huge hunger for this kind of knowledge among people, plumbing, electrical, everyday work in the community, this all can be handled by this kind of method without going to school. Without anyway, in school you don't really. I'm
90% I upgraded my own laptop by upgrading the RAM myself, just getting the RAM thing. And also the hard disk, I changed to an SSD drive. I did it all through YouTube tutorials. And I did it at home. Screwdriver. And and I'm not trained in IT at all. I'm not trained in computers at all. I'm a layman.
So here I have, unfortunately, the volume is not high. Can you just increase the volume there? I was playing Thai.
เรื่องของผู้เขียนเช่นการตัดการคัดลอกและการวางตีภาพในการเลือกตัวหนาขีดเส้นใต้และตัวเอียงถึงขนาดและสีของตัวอักษรในการเขียนการประยุกต์ใช้คุณสมบัติเหล่านี้ในเอกสารเพื่อทำให้เอกสารเหล่านี้น่าสนใจมากขึ้นและอ่านง่ายขึ้นเมื่อเปรียบเทียบกับตัวอักษรในเอกสารรูปแบบธรรมดาอันนี้เรากำลังใช้ Ubuntu Linux เวอร์ชัน 10.4
I think this has really fired the imagination of everybody, and anyone who has spent any time teaching will really understand what this whole thing is about and how it can revolutionize. It's going to happen. No matter what we do, people are going to learn through the net, learn sitting at home, learn while working. That's going to happen. Whether the present educational systems will adapt to it or will decay is another. Is a challenge for them. I mean, technology is pushing things so fast that either one has to adjust and take the advantage or lose out. So thank you very much, Professor Modgalia, I hope this will not be the last of the times you interact with us. Certainly at RIS, we'll be delighted to welcome you.
Here is that hardware that I talked about.
Yes, so this is another project I wanted to get into Arduino.
Arduino?
Because yes. I'm a radio amateur since the 1960s. Okay. And all this Arduino and things like that has been very intriguing. I have just not got down to actually.
So basically you connect it and then it starts blinking. And
you can do huge amount of things with that, including you can have an oscilloscope which is on your laptop. Earlier, when we had an oscilloscope, it was a huge instrument in the lab. And now with a laptop or even a mobile phone and an Arduino device,
right,
you can have an oscilloscope and do a lot of things. So life is full of new and interesting things going to happen, and you are in the middle of it. I'm at the end of it. I can tell you, when I was a graduate student, the computer was in a building. It was an IBM 360. We had to book space in the memory. 128K was a big deal. 256K was a big deal.
Kilobyte.
And then we had to type all those punch cards, put it in. Most of the time, there would be mistakes. Cards would be in the wrong order.
So this is something we shipped out. This whole package sent by FedEx to every remote center, we could do it in 48 rupees.
Nice.
Right? So everybody had this workshop, 3,200 people, including some 25 people in Myanmar. Right.
So there you are. So today's computer, this one, is probably more capacity than the IBM 360, which we had a huge building in the US. But those are also interesting days for us because, you know, we learned the hard way. So thank you all for coming here, and I hope you'll be in touch with us in the future. And in one form or the other, Professor Modgalia is available on email for any queries or interactions when you go back to your institutions. If there is any interest in working with IIT Bombay on this, he mentioned the time zone. I have a idea about how to handle this. You can have hubs in different time zones. You can have a hub in Africa, which handles the African time zones. You can have another hub in... The biggest problem is Latin America and Caribbean because of 12-hour time difference. You can have a hub in that region, which will handle the... which will work. So a kind of hub...
We can conduct it at night time also.
Well, you know, he's prepared to work 48 hours a day. So all kinds of solutions are possible, and I think we'll... look forward to hearing from you all about this. Thank you.